Republican Senator John Kennedy of Louisiana. He sits on the Senate Judiciary Committee. Senator, thanks for coming in.
You bet, Kate.
So you have said that the justice that you're looking for would be a cross between Socrates and Dirty Harry. Do any of the four candidates that folks are talking about fit that profile?
Well, I like what I see on paper, but we don't know yet. That's why we have a confirmation process. I'm looking for somebody smart, obviously, somebody who's intellectually curious, open-minded, someone who's willing to test his or her assumptions against the arguments of those who disagree. I want somebody at the same time who has the courage of his or her convictions, and I don't want a hater. I'm rather fond of the Constitution, and I think we all are, and I'd like somebody who respects the Bill of Rights and understands why we have a Bill of Rights. You really can't tell whether that standard can be reached until you have confirmation hearings.
You've given it to some of the nominees for other judicial posts. I remember watching many a hearing from you. But what's the Dirty Harry element of this? What about Dirty Harry are you liking here?
Well, this is you've got to know what you believe, and when you think you're right, be willing to stand up and be counted. At the same time, a good judge is open-minded and willing to test his or her assumptions against their critics' arguments. So it's that's both Dirty Harry and Socrates.
Who knew they were so alike? McConnell, according to multiple reports, is saying that Kethledge and Hardiman are going to be the easiest to confirm. Do you agree with Senator McConnell?
I think there's going to be a war, regardless. Look, that's Senator McConnell's job. He's in management. I'm not. I just want to pick. I want the president to pick the very best person, and then allow us plenty of time to see how these folks think. This person thinks.
Yeah.
This may be the most important vote I'll take. Certainly, one of the most important votes I'll take in the United States Congress.
That's for sure.
And I don't come in. Look, I take my job seriously. We all do. I'm not a rubber stamp for anybody. I got some hard questions, whoever the president nominates.
You want to tell me what your first question is?
I want to delve into how they interpret a statute, and therefore how they would interpret the Constitution when it's not clear. I want to understand how they think the judiciary fits in the Madisonian balance of separation of powers.
I want to
know that what they see as the purpose of the Bill of Rights. I think the Bill of Rights is not for the high school quarterback or the prom queen. The Bill of Rights is for somebody in America who kind of sees things a little bit differently and has the right to do that. So I'm going to use my time wisely, I hope.
Well, we will be watching. I got to ask you, though, you just returned from a trip with a handful of other Republican senators to Russia.
Right.
How exactly did you put it, Senator, to your counterparts when you were in the meeting, when you said you were asking them to not interfere in the election, and what was the response in the room?
Well, I can't speak for my colleagues. I went for two reasons. Number one, to deliver a message. I delivered that to the foreign minister, to the Speaker of the House, and to a number of their senators. And this is what I said. Number one, stop screwing with American elections. Number two, get out of eastern Ukraine and let them self-determine. Number three, get out of Crimea and let Crimea self-determine. Number four, stop screwing around in Syria and help us settle the mess. And number five, do not allow Iran to get a foothold in southern Syria, because if you do that, there's going to be another war. Israel's not going to stand for it. The foreign minister meeting was probably the toughest. We exchanged words. He's a bully. He impressed me as the sort of guy who started out in the world as a smart ass and worked his way up. And it was a pretty tough meeting, but I think our message was delivered, and my colleagues did the same thing. I also was able to draw some conclusions about Russia. People say, well, what kind of political system do they have? They don't have. It's all about Putin. They don't have a political philosophy. What's the political philosophy of the mafia? There is none. It's all about money and power, and there's no free press.
So did you leave that meeting any more confident that the upcoming election will happen free of Russian interference?
I don't know. I really don't know. But I told them, and then my colleagues did as well, look, if you screw with the elections this fall, the Congress is going to double down on sanctions, and you're not going to like it.
What did he say to you? I assume the reaction was, we didn't do it, because that's what we've heard publicly. But what did they say to you?
Well, it got testy at times. They, of course, deny everything. And I expected them to. Look, the last time that the Russian government embraced Western values and democracy was never. We're not going to convert their political leadership. We're going to have to contain them. And the only way to contain them, you don't have to be ugly about it, but you got to be very, very firm. Dealing with Putin is like hand-feeding a shark. You can do it, but you have to do it very, very carefully.
Senator, did you really say stop screwing with our election? You really said that to the foreign minister?
Yes. Yes. And
I want to make sure I'm getting the quotes.
We didn't hit it off very well at all.
Someone who wasn't there, that your recall of it sounds like you guys aren't getting a beer anytime soon.
We're not. He's a bully. And I didn't much appreciate it. And I told him.
What was the bullying tactic? I mean, now I'm fascinated. Take me in there.
He's just always trying to get you off balance. For example, I called him Mr. Ambassador, and he made a big play about the fact that he wasn't an ambassador. He was a foreign minister. If you ask him a question, he tries to turn the question back on you. He's belligerent. Like I say, I mean, I don't mean disrespect, but he started out as a wise ass and worked his way up. And I didn't much appreciate it. We didn't yell at each other. We didn't call each other names, but we were both pretty firm.
Real quick, I've got a million more questions, but this is all ahead of the president meeting with Putin next week. He was asked, you brought up Crimea when you were over there. He was asked by reporters on Air Force One a couple weeks ago recently if recognizing the annexation of Crimea would be up for discussion. And his response to reporters was, we're going to have to see. Do you think that's a real possibility coming out of a face-to-face with Putin?
I don't know what the president's going to talk about with President Putin, but I know this. The Crimea should be allowed to self-determine. So should Eastern Ukraine. Now, the Russian government, I want to distinguish the Russian government from the Russian people, who deserve better. Their position is, we didn't do anything. Well, they're not telling the truth. We know they did. We know they meddled in our election. The most immediate threat, though, to world peace is, frankly, in Syria. If Russia keeps playing footsie with the Iranians and lets them establish a foothold in southern Syria, the Israelis going to knock the hell out of them. I mean, that's just a fact.
Are you nervous about President Trump meeting face to face with Putin?
No, I'm curious. Okay. My expectations are low. I say, you're not going to convert Putin. You're going to have to contain him.
Senator John Kennedy, thanks for coming in. Always a pleasure.
You bet.